Good morning.
Good morning.
It's great to be in the house of the Lord today, isn't it?
Amen.
What do you think? It's good. Isn't it good? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Isn't it good? Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord?
Oh, amen.
Yeah. So we got just a few announcements before we get started. And looks like we got the senior luncheon coming up tomorrow. Isn't that awesome? I don't know if any of you have been to Brick Road Bistro, but I could tell you from personal experience, I've had everything on the menu there, and it's really good. So it looks like you guys are going to meet there 12:30 p.m. tomorrow. If you got any questions, Michelle's back there. Just talk to her or Becky. And don't see Becky this morning, but yeah. And also wanted to mention that this week, the men, we're going to have a dinner. Thursday, March the 16th at 6 p.m. We're going to meet at Rob's Restaurant. That's in Brookville. Yeah, you're going to be there, right? Right. And it's an all-you-can-eat buffet. So just letting you guys know, if you haven't been there, it's an all-you-can-eat buffet. And we're going to actually fellowship, and I'm going to talk about the study we're going to be getting into in the month of April. And then also the following Sunday, BBS is going to have a decoration and props meeting that'll be prior to Sunday night church. It'll be at 4:30 p.m. So if you would like to serve the Lord in the capacity of maybe your building skills or your decoration skills for VBS, please show up at the meeting before Sunday night church next week on March 19th. And this is the last day, too. My wife wanted me to reiterate that if you wanted to be part of the Women of Grace painting class, it's going to be Thursday, March the 23rd at 6:30 p.m. Today is the last day to sign up in guest services. So there's a sign-up sheet back there, and the reason for that is Stephanie and Sherry, they need a little time to order some of the supplies, paintbrushes if you don't have them, and also the canvases. And there's also a sample of the painting that you're going to be doing back in the back. I know my wife was up really late last night doing that. Sorry, I didn't mean to embarrass you. But you were down in the art area of the house, and it looks really good, I think, honey. You did a good job with it. And then there's going to be a big youth night at Miami University Friday, March 24th to Saturday, March 25th. It's for grades 7 through 12. There's going to be swimming, rock climbing, boulder cave, which I'm not sure what that is about. I don't know. Are you going to have boulders come slamming down at you like the Indiana Jones movie or something?
I'm going to try to stay awake.
You're going to stay awake, yeah, because it's like an all-night deal. And there's going to be basketball, dodgeball, cornhole, ping pong, pizza, et cetera, guest speaker. And talk to Cody up here if you're interested in going.
Well, the registration is over. They had us registered last Sunday, so
okay.
What we got.
What you got's what you got. How many you got going?
We just have the four youth and then 3 leaders.
4 youth and 3 leaders, and what, there's about 50 other churches going?
What?
50 other churches going?
I have no idea how many other churches are going.
They're doing a join with New Paris, though.
For yeah. Okay, that's good. That's good. And so, like, the men's breakfast is coming up the last Saturday of March as well. 8 a.m. we get together and cook. 9 a.m. if you're not into cooking and you want to come eat a meal with us. And then we usually have a devotion about 10 a.m. And that's a really great time. If you got any questions, just come talk to me after church. And then the women's Bible study. You girls are in the book of Romans. I think you're doing the John MacArthur deal, right? Right. And that's going to be at Discuss Chapter 2 in the book, Monday, March 27th, 10 a.m. at Becky's house. And we also got Michaela's birthday, so if you see her this month, wish her a happy birthday, because is today the 11th? That was yesterday? That was yesterday. So her birthday was yesterday. That's awesome. And let's just go to the Lord in prayer this morning before we start our worship service. And I say, Father in heaven, you are the wonderful counselor, Lord, Prince of Peace, the creator of the heavens and universe. And just want to take time this morning, Lord, to just say thank you just for the very air that we breathe. Lord, without you, we would be nothing. And I just humbly ask that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Please forgive us of our sins, O Lord, as all of us here fall short every day. And we just humbly ask that you would guide and direct us, Lord, through your word. Lord, please bless all these people for being here for church. And thank you for giving us your word throughout Sunday school, church, Sunday night, even Wednesday night, Lord, and also with all the women that you've blessed with your word throughout the months, and the men as well, Lord. We just want to follow you, Lord. Please help us with your word. That way we can set our own opinions aside and see what you have to say about God's about your word, Lord. That way we can apply it in our lives. That way as a Christian people set apart, that we might be able to work on our righteousness as we work through the process of sanctification. And Lord, we anticipate your arrival, and we just humbly ask that we have several that are sick, and we just ask that since you are the great physician, Lord, that you would heal them, Lord. And we have several that we would love to know you. Please help us to witness to them. Help us to give them the gospel message, Lord. And that way some more of our loved ones would come to follow you, Lord, before you return. And we thank you for an opportunity to get together as brothers and sisters in Christ to worship your great name. And we thank you for this wonderful day. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you'll stand with us as we sing our first song.
I confess, bowing near, I find my rest without you. song of liberty, rising from the African plain. It's the song of liberty.
Scripture reading this morning will be in the Psalms. If you would please turn there to Psalm chapter 40. And when I was studying this a little bit, I was able to find two great themes in this. And the first one would be looking at God as being merciful and then God as being good. And so when we look at this, we'll see King David, who's talking about the mercy of God in his life in the past. And then in light of that mercy, he encourages other believers to share those together to grow and also to have personal evangelism for those who don't know the Lord. So he's saying that our past trials and tribulations essentially create a desire to draw near to God for mercy because he is good. We'll read through the entire chapter together, and beginning in verse 1, Psalm chapter 40, it reads, "I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the pit of destruction, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Blessed is the man who makes the Lord his trust, who does not turn to the proud, to those who go astray after a lie, who have multiplied. O Lord, my God, your wondrous deeds and your thoughts toward us, none can compare with you. I will proclaim and tell of them, yet they are more than can be told. In sacrifice and offering you have not delighted, but you have given me an open ear. Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required. Then I said, behold, I have come, in the scroll of the book it is written of me. I delight to do your will, O my God, your law is within my heart. I have told the glad news of deliverance in the great congregation. Behold, I have not restrained my lips, as you know, O Lord. I have not hidden your deliverance within my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your salvation. I have not concealed your steadfast love and your faithfulness from a great congregation. As for you, O Lord, you will not restrain your mercy from me. Your steadfast love and your faithfulness will ever preserve me. For evils have encompassed me beyond number. My iniquities have overtaken me, and I cannot see. They are more than the hairs of my head. My hairs fail me. Be pleased, O Lord, to deliver me. O Lord, make haste to help me. Let those be put to shame and disappointed altogether who seek to snatch away my life. Let those be turned back and brought to dishonor who delight in my hurt. Let those be appalled because of their shame who say to me, aha, aha. But may all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. Let those who love your salvation say continually, great is the Lord. As for me, I am poor and needy, but the Lord takes thought for me. You are my help and my deliverer. Do not delay, O my God. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who is God. Thank you for salvation in him. Thank you for allowing us to see back in the Old Testament all the examples of people you were merciful to. Today in Sunday school, we continue to learn about Joseph, and we'll continue to see how you're merciful to him. For those who draw near to you, you are merciful, Lord, and you are good. And it is in your Son that we have salvation and we have continual renewal. And I pray that we'll see the example in King David here and how he put his faith in the Lord and how we can see that and see more of it in our personal evangelism. Because to evangelize more effectively, we just need to see more of Christ. To have a grander picture of him, we need to be in your Word. And so I pray for the people here today that they will be in the Word of God more and more, and that they will continue to see mercy. And as we continue to see mercy that you have given us in our life, we can be an example for those who are lost in personal evangelism. I pray that you'll give us the power to see your goodness as we continue to study your word, to see how you are good to people who draw near to you. And for those who don't know you, Lord, that might be here today, I pray that they'll see the example here in King David, and that they'll be able to see the mercy and the goodness of our great Lord, and that they'll come to know Jesus Christ in faith. I pray all these things in your name. Amen.
If you'll stand once again as we sing All Creatures of Our God and King.
Oh,
Morning. How are y'all this morning? It's wonderful to see all of you. If you would open your Bibles with me to John chapter 9. Lord willing, we will finish John chapter 9 this morning. Some of you can clap and, you know, be excited about that. But it's been fun, hasn't it? It's been an interesting look. Jesus healing the blind man. Those of you who haven't been with us, he's healed a blind man, a man born blind. A man that we learned was not born blind because of his own sin, which in many of our minds seems ridiculous, but the rabbis thought those things could happen. But he also was not born blind because of his parents' sin. And many of us might think that someone born blind, it's because the parents had sinned, and the rabbis taught that too. But no, Jesus said he was born blind for the glory of God. And we got to witness Jesus heal this man. And we see how God used this man's blindness to demonstrate that Jesus is the Messiah. And so that is incredible. And now we are going to see, since we've been talking about physical blindness this whole time, we all knew it was leading somewhere else, didn't we? So now we're going to see that this man's spiritual blindness is also healed. And this is the big takeaway. And sorry to ruin the end of the sermon for you, but I think you all knew it was headed here, right? And so, but the big question is, and it's going to be asked by Jesus to the blind man, do you believe in the Son of God? And so that's why I've titled the message this way. And of course, I always like to ask a couple of questions before we get into this. So I would like to ask that question up front. Do you believe in the Son of God? Let me explain what I mean by belief. It is not, do you have factual head knowledge about Jesus? Because again, frankly, any person can pick up the Bible and learn factual head knowledge about Jesus. Even an unbeliever can read the plain text of Scripture and find out the events that took place in Jesus' life. Having facts about Jesus is not what Jesus is meaning by believe. Something you need to know in the New Testament, the Greek word for believe is the same word for faith or for trust. Faith, trust, belief, all are defined by this one root Greek word called pistis, which means faith. It means trust. It doesn't just mean head knowledge. So understand that when I ask the question, do you trust in the Son of God? That says a very different thing, doesn't it, than just to believe a fact in your mind. A lot of people come to faith with this idea because they know the facts. And, oh yeah, I've prayed a prayer. Now all of a sudden I'm saved. It may be the case, but it also may not be the case. And how many have we watched make those exact professions, walk away from the faith just a short time after? So understand what we're asking. Now, if you do believe, what are you doing with that belief? And again, this is going to come up at the very end of the sermon again. You are to be a light in this world. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And of course, Jesus went to be with the Father in heaven. He now sits at the right hand of the Father in heaven. But in the Gospels, if you remember, in Matthew, in the Sermon on the Mount, he said, you are the light of the world. Do you remember that? And so what are you doing with that light? If you are a believer, a true believer in faith in the Lord Jesus, what are you doing with the light? And we need to take a look. I'm only going to ask those two questions this morning because I think they give you something to start turning the wheels on what is happening in this sermon. Let's pray together, and then we are going to get into starting in John 9. We're going to move back just a little bit into verse 31, tie it in, and then move forward. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are a wonderful God. You are a gracious and merciful God. Father, we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for you, from the foundation of the world, making a plan of redemption and then enacting that plan of redemption throughout all of human history to bring about the Messiah, the Savior of the world, the Lord Jesus, the eternal Son of God, to save us. And you brought him forth at a particular point to put on the flesh of mankind. And Father, to go to a cross to pay for sin, whereby he shed his blood to cover the sins of all those who would believe. His blood is enough to cover all sin. And so all those who place their faith in Christ, his blood cleanses us and justifies us from our own sin. And we have the forgiveness of sins from you. And Father, we have reconciliation and peace with you. And God, we are now justified, those of us who have placed our faith in Jesus, in heaven, having a place in the heavenlies even now, according to your word. God, it is you who has done this mighty work of salvation in our lives, and we praise you for it. And God, we praise you for placing your Holy Spirit inside all of those who have trusted, that he might lead us into all truth and teach us how to live a holy life, a process theologically, Father, that's called sanctification, as you know. But it moves us from who we were to who we are supposed to be in Christ, in the image of your dear Son. And so, Father, we pray that you would do this not only in every person sitting here who hasn't trusted Christ, but that every person who might even watch this on the stream or hear this message, that, Father, you would do this through your word. You would transform their hearts the way you have this blind man in John chapter 9. And, Father, we'll give you all the glory, because salvation is an act of God. It is not an act of man. It is not of works, lest we would obviously boast about it. Father, help us to be humble people, knowing that you are the agent of salvation. You are the one who has worked the work, and you are the one who accomplishes this in every life and brings it to pass. So, Father, help us to take the gospel out in the world, doing the part you have told us to play. Help us, God, to take the gospel out to the dark, into the dark, to those who are lost, those who have not trusted you. Father, spur your church on to be people of holiness and righteousness, but also people who love the Lord enough and love people enough to take his gospel to them. The only means of salvation you have given is Christ. So help us, Father, to do that work. Father, we pray in our church that you would unify us, that you would help us to understand this word together and keep sharpening one another as iron sharpens iron. Help us to be noble, like the Bereans were in Acts 17:11, when it says they were more noble than the Thessalonians because they searched the scriptures daily to find out if these things were true. Help us not to take the word of a man, but your word as truth. Father, I pray for each one you've sent this morning. I pray that you would bless them, that you would grow them. Father, that you would bind us together in unity as a strong local body of Christ, founded on Christ's blood and the word of God, and that this would give us our marching orders for how to live in righteousness, holiness, Father, in faith. We love you and praise you. Father, we give you all glory and honor. We pray that you will use your word this morning in our hearts. We love you and praise you again in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank you. Let's read, starting in verse 31. I'm just going to read to the end of the chapter so that we all know the text we're dealing with. Now we know that God does not hear sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, he hears him. Since the world began, it has been unheard of that anyone opened the eyes of one who was born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered and said to him, "You were completely born in sins. Are you teaching us?" And they cast him out. Jesus heard that he had been cast out, and when he had found him, he said to him, "Do you believe in the Son of God?" He answered and said, "Who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him?" And Jesus said to him, "You have both seen him, and it is he who is talking with you." Then he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. And Jesus said, "For judgment I have come into this world, that those who do not see may see, and that those who see may be made blind." Then some of the Pharisees who were with him heard these words and said to him, "Are we blind also?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would have no sin. But now you say, 'We see,' therefore your sin remains." And so this is our text for this morning. And I think most of you will pick up on the context as we've been talking about this for weeks now, several weeks, I think, maybe three or four sermons already in John chapter 9. But if you look at what's happening here, this is the blind man's response to the Pharisees questioning him again. Remember, he's been questioned several times during this chapter. But the Pharisees are questioning him again. How are you now able to see? You know, your parents affirmed you were blind, so we'll believe that now that we heard them say it. But how are you made well? Because we know this man, and they're pointing at Jesus. Remember, they won't use his name. This man is a sinner. And that's what they said about Jesus. Why? Well, the things we've been saying before. Jesus made himself out to be God. And you'll remember a couple times we've already demonstrated, and a couple times coming up, they pick up stones to stone Jesus because he made himself out to be God. He said, "Before Abraham was, I am. And they immediately picked up stones because they knew exactly what he was saying. He claimed to be the voice out of the burning bush talking to Moses in the law, in the Torah. And so you know good and well that they took him to be saying he was God. And we've discussed this a bunch. So they don't like Jesus. They will not use his name. They think he's blaspheming by calling himself, who is a man in their eyes, God. And so don't miss all of the context here. But understand this. This man says it plainly, and you need to understand, if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, God hears him. And you'll recall from last week, we even went and looked at the verse they're referencing about he who allows iniquity in his heart or regards iniquity in his heart will not be heard by God. We read that. That's what they're quoting. That's what they're thinking about. But here, this man says, God doesn't hear sinners, but yet look at what this man, Jesus, is able to do. He healed a blind man. And we went and looked specifically at Psalm 42, if you'll remember. Only the Messiah, only God himself, is going to be able to heal the sight of one born blind. And this man says it very plainly. He says in verse 32, since the world began, it has been unheard of that anyone opened the eyes of one who was born blind. And you could search the whole scripture. There are times when God blinds someone and then unblinds them. The Syrian army in the book of 2 Kings with Elisha, you'll remember when the servant couldn't see all of the angelic hosts that were there, the warriors, when he couldn't see, Elisha prayed that he would open his eyes. Well, right after that, the eyes of the army is blinded and they are led into Samaria, and then their blindness is taken away by God and they open their eyes and here they are in Samaria. And they all leave, and Syria never comes and attacks Israel again after that point. Well, yeah, God healed blind people, but he also made them blind right then and there, healed them shortly after as a demonstration of his power to the army of Syria. But one who had been born blind, there is no record anywhere, not in the scripture, not in any other record, of a person actually being healed from congenital or blindness from birth. Just understand. This man is speaking truth. All the rabbis knew this. All the rabbis expected that the Messiah would be the one opening the eyes of the blind. You can now start to see very plainly the rebellion of these people. The Pharisees specifically in this group here are the ones talking, you know, to this man. They will not yield to Jesus, even when all the evidence points to him being the Messiah, the very one that God has sent. Listen to this. We had a discussion about this on Wednesday night in the book of James, verse 16 in chapter 5. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And we went on and on, if you'll remember, those of you here on Wednesday nights, about the effective prayer. There's a difference between an ineffective and an effective prayer. You know that, right? Those of you who weren't here, let me demonstrate. Here's an ineffective prayer. Oh, dear God, give me a Mercedes. That's an ineffective prayer. Because, again, an effective prayer has to do with praying according to the will of God. Now, if you have enough money to buy your own Mercedes, nobody is saying you can't go buy yourself a Mercedes. It's your money. Do with it what you want. That isn't what we're saying. We aren't saying if you own a Mercedes, you're wicked. No, if you've got enough money for a Mercedes and that's what you want to buy with your money, do it. That's up to you. That's between you and God. But when you pray to God to give you a Mercedes when you can't afford it, when you don't need it, and you're asking him to just give you something that is completely arbitrary to the life you're supposed to be living for God. And we could use much bigger things. How many ministries have we watched pray for G6 jets? A $50 million or $60 million jet? Again, if you're a super wealthy billionaire and you can afford your own jet, more power to you. I would love, in one sense, in a carnal way, right, to have billions of dollars where I can afford my own jet and just fly anywhere I want. Of course, who wouldn't? But when you drain $50 or $60 million from a ministry, that kind of praying becomes ineffective. And really, we could even go further. That becomes an ungodly prayer, a prayer that doesn't have a place in ministry. And here's the point. When we pray for selfish things, for things that aren't in the will of God, that aren't in the plan of God, that have nothing to do with kingdom growth or kingdom, you know, work, why are we praying for that stuff? You know, many times our prayers are very selfish. And that's the problem in James. That's the problem when you look at Jesus here, because Jesus clearly never prays that way. He only prays according to the will of God. And when he prays, what does God do? Answers every single prayer he makes, because he never makes a selfish prayer. He prays according to the will of his Father in heaven. He said it over and over here in the book of John. So as application for us, from Wednesday night and from this text, we need to be praying according to the will of God, folks. You need to really consider the types of prayers you make. And again, an effective prayer is going to be one prayed according to the will of God. But it's also going to be a prayer that, you know, is not only asking God to move, but to move on something that is important, that you care about, that the Word of God speaks about. How about praying for the lost? How about praying diligently or fervently as the next word? How about praying your effective prayers fervently and passionately and over? Pray without ceasing. How about this? And again, a question I asked on Wednesday night, and again, a lot of people amended it and affirmed it, is, you know, pray without ceasing and pray with passion. Do you want your prayers to be answered by God or not? How many of us sometimes feel like our prayers are bouncing off the ceiling? And again, it's going to be coming down to the fact that we're either praying in an ineffective way, something that is outside the will of God, or something that is selfish, self-centered. I don't mean to scold you, but it is something that is on my heart. You know how often I bring prayer up, because I think a daily prayer life with God is important for spiritual people. I think the Christians who aren't taking time to pray every day, you're ineffective. You are less than you could be in the kingdom of God. That is for sure. No matter what you think personally, you are less effective than you could be in the kingdom if you're not getting alone with your Lord. And I've backed this up with Scripture. Jesus brought up the same patterned prayer, the Lord's Prayer, we call it, in two separate times in the gospel, two completely separate contexts. And he teaches the disciples how to pray the same way twice. And so prayer needs to be something that we do. And we can see Jesus' prayer is always heard. And this man is wise enough in this moment with God transforming his heart to see that. That Jesus could not heal a blind man if God didn't give him the ability to do it. Now, he may not understand that he is God in the moment when he says that, right? But he knows that God is working through him, because it couldn't happen otherwise. Since the world began, it's been unheard of, and I've already dealt with that. Look at this. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. He says plainly what we've been gathering from the entire narrative, that Jesus wouldn't have the power to do anything if he wasn't from God. None of these signs. Jesus must be from God just because of the very things he's doing, right? You see that? That's the point I'm trying to make. Jesus told them previously, look, if you don't believe me, at least believe the works. Let me back that up with Scripture so you don't think Rodney's making this up. John chapter 5. Jump back four chapters from here, verse 36. But I have a greater witness than John's, and he's referring to John the Baptist in that passage, for the works which the Father has given me to finish, the very works that I do bear witness of me that the Father has sent me. And he will say it later in the book of John, if you don't believe me from my words, believe for the work's sake. That's coming in the book of John. He hasn't said it yet. But these are things that are clear from Jesus' words, that my works are demonstrating that I came from the Father. And that's the very thing we're talking about here. No one from the foundation of the world has ever healed one born blind, yet Jesus did. And yet the common understanding and the teaching of the rabbis is Jesus is a sinner because he's blaspheming, saying he's God. And he heals on the Sabbath, by the way. You all know that was an issue too, but it's not brought up in the context here. It was earlier. So it's important. And look at what their response is. This is the rabbi's response. You were completely born in sins. Do you see that they said that to him? That's in verse 34. You were completely born in sins. And yeah, they say more. I'll deal with that in a second. But notice what they're saying. They're hearkening back to the same thing that the disciples implied at the very beginning of this chapter. Do you remember? Lord, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And the very first sermon that we did in this chapter was Jesus gave a third option, didn't he? And it was the right option. Is God caused this man to be blind from birth so that God could get glory when Jesus healed him? It was plain. The disciples didn't think that way. The rabbis in that day didn't think that way. Congenital blindness had to be either the parents had sinned, and again, we do this sometimes, don't we? When we see a baby who has a deformity or something we don't understand, we immediately jump to, well, they were a smoker, or they did something else, or maybe it was sexual sin that caused this. And those things are all possibilities. I mean, we aren't discounting that sin can lead to corruption and problems and issues. But do we always know? Do we have all the insight to know that kind of a thing? Of course not. And so we assume, as they assume, and they even made a bigger assumption. They said, well, if the parents didn't sin, maybe that baby in the womb sinned somehow. And again, that almost sounds ridiculous to most of us, doesn't it? We don't even think that kind of way. Because we don't think a little baby in a womb could sin, but you need to know, and I told you this before, the rabbis used to say that. Some of the rabbis, if you go back into rabbinic literature like the Talmud and the Mishnahs and stuff, the commentaries on the Bible from the ancient Jewish people, some of the rabbis believe that way, and they would dispute with one another that a baby can sin because it's born with original sin, so even in the womb, it can sin. Again, I told you, I don't believe that's even possible. I think it's ridiculous because God doesn't impute sin unless there's understanding of what has been done. Someone has to know they are a sinner before sin can actually be imputed. This is important. But these are the kinds of things going on in the minds of these people. And some of them, like the Pharisees here, they're saying to this man, look, you're completely born in sin. Your blindness proves it. You're a sinner. You are absolutely a wicked sinner, and we're better than you. Now, you might not be reading it that way, but can you see the implication? That's what's being said here. And frankly, this is so common. Look at the very next part of that same verse. And they said, you are completely born in sins, and are you teaching us? Look at what they're saying. We're not going to listen to you. You're a complete sinner, way more sinful than we are. Don't try to instruct us. We're not accepting your instruction. Now I want you to consider something. I wrote a statement here because I wanted to read it in its full, because in my mind, this is true. It is a fact that many academics, wealthy people, and even religious leaders quite often exalt themselves above everyone else. Now that's a fact, I think, in ancient times, at the time here we're seeing with the Pharisees, because we know historically that is absolutely true. A Pharisee was the most conservative of the religious leaders in Judaism. They absolutely would not allow themselves to be instructed by anyone who wasn't considered a very holy, pious, godly person. Now, it was fake and it was false many times. It was hypocritical, but this was the standard. And if you look in academia today, they do the same thing. Academics, Dr. So-and-so, he'll say, well, I'm a doctor and I'm well studied in this and you're not, so I don't want you instructing me. How many Christians run into this? How many Christians who are biblical Christians with spiritual understanding of this book run into this often with academics in the world today? It happens all the time. Wealthy people do the same thing. Oh, I was born in a station above you. Now, am I saying every wealthy person? No, because I'm not stereotyping in the sense that every single human being is this way, but it's easier for a wealthy person who has a lot of money and has a lifestyle well above yours, who doesn't follow God, to put themselves above everyone else. You're just a little serf. You're a little pleb, and I'm at this station up here. And they do. How many religious leaders do this too? You would be shocked, if you don't know it already, to watch, and even some of the so-called churches around the world, to watch what they do with some of the pastors in these churches. They'll set them in golden throne-like chairs, and some of the people will come up and kiss their feet and things. When a Bible-believing, normal pastor goes and sees this kind of stuff, they always protest. But around the world, this is common. You see it on TV sometimes, the elevation of a man like a Benny Hinn or a Kenneth Copeland or something, almost cult-like. And this is exactly right. That's what a cult leader does. Look, I'm the Messiah, or I am the vessel God is using. You notice I never do this kind of thing. I tell you, look, me and you, we're on the same level. I have a role as a pastor. That is a role in the church, but it doesn't elevate me above you. In fact, what did Jesus say? If you want to be greatest in the kingdom of heaven, you'll what? Become the servant of all. You won't elevate yourself above other people and demand that they bow at your feet and kiss your toes. Doesn't matter what role you have. The prophets of old did not do that. None of the apostles acted that way. In fact, when Paul would argue that he's an apostle and it's clear and they should be listening to the apostle, he never forced abject worship or anything like that. This is important for you to understand that these religious leaders are elevating themselves above everyone else. And even though this guy says what's right, they refuse to even hear it, much less absorb it, think about it, consider it. They won't hear it from his mouth. And frankly, this is so normal, even today, that it's scary. But you'll notice the next thing that happens. Look at the very last line of 34. And they cast him out. And again, we talked about this a little bit last week. They cast him out of the synagogue, is what it's saying. Not they cast him out of the building they're standing in. Be very clear about that. They had already warned earlier in this same chapter. Do you remember the parents when the parents came? The parents, or somebody, John, had recorded there that the Pharisees had already threatened anyone who proclaims that Jesus is the Christ, or that word means Messiah, just so you know. Anyone who claims that Jesus is the Messiah will be cast out of the synagogue. And here is this man proclaiming to them that Jesus is the Messiah. Rightly, he's using the evidence that's available, but they cast him out because they're not willing to even hear it or think about it. And notice, I should say, just so we're clear, Judaism, ancient Israel, it's more than just a religious belief. You know that, right? I think we do enough a good enough job around here talking about this, but I want to be sure. Judaism is more than just a religious system. Judaism is also the way of society. It's the way of life. It's both a civil and a religious belief. When you're in a synagogue, you need to think about this. Like, the neighborhoods are structured in such a way that they all have a local synagogue with rabbis or leaders that teach the neighborhood, the community in that area. This is where they meet for church. This is where they meet to talk about things going on in the society. If they want to vote on religious things, they would go and do that at a synagogue. And, you know, sometimes the things would be elevated to the Sanhedrin at the global level, right? But a lot of times things were talked about at the synagogue level that have everything to do with society. So if you are cast out of the synagogue and you become a pariah in your neighborhood, you have no voice anymore. You lose all your connection to your friends. You are going to be, by everybody or nearly everybody, shunned. They're going to say the rabbis kicked you out because you're in sin. You're in rebellion against the leadership. That's a big deal in ancient Judaism. It's almost no deal at all in the church today, is it? It's a sad state of affairs we find the church in today. It's very difficult, and you know that here in this church, we practice church discipline as a rule. We don't allow one another to walk in open sin without somebody pulling them aside and saying, hey, this is wrong, right? But you got to know, in the church in general, that is not happening. Some churches practice proper biblical church discipline. Others do not. But why? Because there are so many other churches to go to, in many cases, they're afraid that people just walk out the door. They'll just walk over here to the other church. And trust me, I've been a pastor since 2012. The number of times other churches have contacted me or the church about people who have been removed or have left disgruntled from a church I've been in and pastoring, it is so rare we could count them on one hand. Literally, most churches don't even contact. But as I've shown you, and it's really important to remember, and I know you may feel like this is derailing, but I'm trying to show you the principle they're living under. Even when Jesus talked about this, in Matthew 18, when you see those three steps, right? We go one-on-one to a person to talk about sin. We may take more if they won't hear the one person. And eventually we may elevate it to the level of the church, right? Church leadership or the church in general, whatever. You'll elevate it to the church level. But if you'll remember, right after that, Jesus also says, what is bound on earth is going to be bound in heaven. So when a local church rightly removes a member from membership or gives them over to Satan, whichever one you want to say, that is being bound in heaven just like it is being bound on earth. And I'll tell you, watching this happen a handful of times over the years, I've seen this happen. Almost always the person who is kicked out goes away grumbling and complaining about things, but it's almost like their life stalls to the point where God doesn't allow them to move forward spiritually unless they come back and reconcile. Almost always, you'll see this. When somebody leaves, because why? Because what's being bound here by the leadership in your local church is what's being bound in heaven. This is an important concept. Now, the Jews practice this kind of stuff, but not even just at the religious level, at the societal level. They believed that this was what God was doing. Now, when you corrupt it, it becomes a hypocritical system. You put layer after layer of extra commands and rules and things that actually aren't biblical. It becomes a really hard thing to peer through. But for a Jew on the ground in these days, this is what they had to contend with. This man is being thrown out of the synagogue. He's being removed from their society because he is right, and he wants to worship the true Savior, the true God, but he's being thrown out. This is a tragedy, and you need to see that it's a tragedy. Jesus heard, notice verse 35, Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and he went and found him. So Jesus heard what was going on, and notice there too, it's very much like today. If something happens, it doesn't take very long for everybody to know, right? And again, sometimes as a pastor or a leader in a church, you'll warn people, look, don't spread this around. This is going to cause division, strife. Don't spread it around. We're not there yet. You know, if you reach the point of church discipline where it goes before the whole church, okay, then open it up. Everybody has a right to know. This is a church-wide thing. They're being instructed to pray for them, that God will turn them back. And when they see them out there, that they are to confront their sin and to tell them to turn back. Of course. But at the other steps, if somebody comes and or if I go to somebody and I'm dealing with sin, or somebody comes and deals with me with sin, that should be happening too, by the way. If I'm in sin, you ought to come deal with me over it. But if that happens, the two of us should leave that in the one-on-one, especially if there's repentance and there's turning. It should be left there. But how many times do people catch wind of something and all of a sudden, well, I want to know what happened. What happened? Yeah, I know it's natural for us to be a little nosy. But it gets worse when you start introducing more folks into this. Because now you bring three other witnesses in or something, and now you got four or five people involved. That's much harder to contain. You warn everybody, look, don't spread this. It's just going to break people's hearts. It's just going to hurt people. Even your spouses. Do you guys know that? Sometimes pastors, they can't share with their spouses some of the conversations and some of the things. And a lot of times, some of you will know, I've told you, look, I won't share this, even with my wife. One, I don't want her to have to deal with every single hardship that somebody's going through. But two, sometimes it's none of her business. I know that sounds harsh. Now, there are other things, of course, my wife comes into and she gets brought into. But there are times when, you know, as a pastor, you got to protect your wife from hearing and dealing with some of the things that are going on. I don't want her to think badly about somebody. You know, especially if they've fallen into some kind of a sin and it's just a one-on-one thing, we're dealing with it and things are going well. I don't want her to know that or think about that or worry about that. You guys, as other members of the body, need to do the same thing. If you have a one-on-one conversation with people, keep that thing private. Don't share it. You will save yourself a lot of heartache and a lot less damage will be done. And again, I know you feel like I've wandered, and I get it. But I do want you to know these things are important. The rumor mill spreads quickly, and that's what you're seeing here. Jesus caught wind of the fact that this man had been cast out of the synagogue. Now, we don't know. Is it a few hours? Is it a few moments? Who knows? But somehow, this got back to Jesus. And you might be thinking, well, Jesus is God. He just knew it. That's true on one level, but it seems to be indicating he heard from someone that this had happened. So it's following, we need to stop the gossip. But anyway, this gets back to Jesus. He answered and said, who is he, Lord, that I, or I'm sorry, I got to read the verse 35. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and when he had found him, he said to him, do you believe in the Son of God? And you'll notice how I titled the message, right? Now, there is something here I need to deal with before we look at this in full. The original text of the Bible doesn't say, do you believe in the Son of God? And again, if you have an ESV Bible or a New American Standard, are any of you using a New American Standard, an ESV, or a new literal translation like a paraphrase Bible? Almost all of the new Bibles have cleaned this up. The New King James followed the older reading from the King James, which I was a little shocked at, to be honest, but they did. What this actually says in the Greek is, do you believe in the Son of Man? That's literally what it says. In the oldest manuscripts we have, in every case, it says, do you believe in the Son of Man? Somehow a translator changed that later for some reason, and some of the more modern, newer, you know, manuscripts, when I say modern and newer, I'm talking the last 1,000 years or so, they started to say, do you believe in the Son of God? Let me help you with this in a couple of ways. The translation is certain, and if you, like I said, if you have an ESV, New American Standard, LSB, NLT, any of these more modern, eclectic text Bibles, you're going to see it says, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" But you'll recall from the New Testament, Jesus' favorite thing to call himself in the New Testament is Son of Man, not Son of God. And in fact, there is something else bigger that you need to know. The phrase Son of God does not appear in the Old Testament. Now, some of you have the book of Daniel chapter 3, and you're going to say, well, yes, it does. So, again, know that that's a mistranslation too. Because while it says Son of God in English, what the actual text says underlying it, and again, check your ESV or your New American Standard, it says he looks like the Son of God, of the gods, is literally what it says in Daniel 3. So the phrase Son of God does not appear in the Old Testament. It is not there. The only Bible they had at the time when Jesus is making these statements is the Old Testament. The New Testament had not been written yet. No part of it had been written at the point when these words are actually happening on the ground with Jesus in the flesh. And so to say Son of God would be weird, and it would introduce a very hard reading for a Jew in that day. They don't know the Messiah, and nothing in the Old Testament points them to that phrase, Son of God. So just understand, it's as clear as it can be to scholars that this is a mistranslation. They've done it because we today, and you know, people have for a long time, we call Jesus the Son of God. In the New Testament, right here in the book of John, New Testament uses this term 45 times. Here in the book of John, it is used 10 times. So 9 technically, let's erase the one here, because this says Son of Man. But do you know, in all 9 other cases, it is actually Son of God in every case. But here, what Jesus is trying to do, and the whole passage has been trying to do, is associate Jesus as the Messiah. And the messianic term coming out of the book of Daniel, if you'll remember, for Jesus is the Son of Man. Why? Because in that great prophecy where the Son of Man comes on the clouds to the Ancient of Days and he receives a kingdom. Do you remember that? This is huge in the minds of the Jews. And Jesus constantly refers to himself as the Son of Man. So you need to know that's what it says. I left it Son of God up here because this is what we are most commonly used to calling Jesus. And frankly, if you have a New King James or a King James, that's what it says here. But it is actually Son of Man, and you need to know what the text actually says. It's important, because when he says this, you all recognize, hopefully, as I did when I was studying for this, this is the heart of the gospel. Jesus is sharing the gospel with this man. What is the first thing you say to a person when you go to talk to them about faith in Christ? Do you believe in Christ? Do you believe in Jesus? Have you trusted Jesus? You know, something like this. This is an important thing, right? And lots of people are going to say, yes, I have. And like we all say around here all the time, you can't stop there. Because sometimes it might just be a head knowledge they have. You need to go further with the questions. But sometimes it may be a declaration of true faith. Absolutely. Jesus is my Lord and my Savior. And that's what we want to hear. And in fact, I wish, and I want to make sure that when we go share the gospel, we are asking these questions. How many ways are there to be saved? Exactly one. John 14:6. It's written in our foyer, right? In a couple of places. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me, or but through me. That's it. Jesus is the one way to faith, so we do need to ask them, have you believed in the Son of God or the Son of Man, if they understand? If you're speaking to an unbeliever in our day, they're almost certainly not even going to get the Son of Man reference. So, but they will the Son of God. I get that. Verse 36, he said to me, who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him? And what I want you to know is that word Lord here is not supposed to be capitalized. Again, I know we're used to doing that in Jesus because in the Old Testament, right, capital Lord is the name of God. But here you need to understand that this is actually referring to the term Lord as in master or sir or something like that. It's a term of respect. And what he's saying is, who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him? He isn't even making the automatic assumption that Jesus is the one he's talking about. But he's trying to be respectful because obviously he saw Jesus heal the blind. Notice that this is interesting too because I didn't plan this, but Michelle and I were having a conversation at the back just a few minutes before this sermon. Sometimes when people are first saved, they don't know all the doctrine. They don't know all the theological terms or the way to say something or how something works. I can remember when I was saved. Now, I had been in and out of church, right, throughout most of my young life. But being in my early 20s, I really didn't know a lot about the Bible. I didn't know about the truths. I might have known some of the stories and things, right, like we all do. But the truths of the doctrines of the gospel or the doctrines of grace, I didn't know all that stuff. I remember going to church, and I knew, like, who the pastor was. He, wonderful guy, shared the word of God with me all the time. But for a long time, when I first came to the faith, I couldn't have even told you what a pastor did. Other than I watched him, you know, talk to people all the time. He preached, taught, you know, different classes and stuff. But outside of that, I would have had no idea. Literally. Because, again, I was like 21, 22 years old. And I didn't know, because while I had gone to church off and on in my early life, I wasn't a great student as an unbeliever. And I was a terrible student in high school. All of school, let's just put it that way. Anyway, it's important that we see what's being said here. Lord, who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him? And Jesus said to him, you have both seen him, and it is he who is talking with you. Now, he can only see him because Jesus healed his blindness. But he's also the one talking. So Jesus makes clear who salvation comes through. Who is the one that can save? Jesus identifies himself, right? Because he is the Messiah. He is the Savior. He is the one who will go on from here and die on a cross to pay for this man's sin, whom he is talking to. This is huge. This is incredible. And again, I think we can learn so much about sharing the gospel through here. Who is he, Lord? It's a great question. And someone, notice here too, that someone whom God is actually changing their heart, they will almost always ask how they can get to know Jesus better. How do I move from a new believer, this new creation, to something more? They don't just stop at the salvation, do they? Oh, I got in. I'm going to go to heaven now. That's all I need. No, a genuine believer who is filled with the Holy Spirit, what will they do? They're gonna start wanting to get involved in everything. I do. I remember my first 3 years in the faith, going to church. I wasn't a pastor, you know, none of that kind of stuff, obviously. I was a brand new Christian. And man, it felt to me like I was on cloud 9, just floating on a cloud for 3 years. I've told people this, and I think sometimes people think I'm weird when I say it, but it's true. I did not even know that there were divisions or strife between Christians for those first 3 years I was in the church. Never saw it, never considered it. It didn't have any effect on who I was and the Lord growing me. Literally, I just was so focused on learning the word, growing in Christ, serving in ministry, doing whatever. I had no idea people were fighting, struggling, that there were frustrations, that there were divisions or strife. I just thought everybody got along, and that's all I saw. Man, was I wrong. I'm messing with you. But it is somewhat true. That it is hard some days because you wonder, you know, why are we fighting so much? We're on the same team. You know, why do the real churches around here, why don't they work together more? Why is there so much division? Especially when we're told not to divide the church. You're not of Paul. You're not of Apollos. You're not of Peter. You're not of Jesus. You're a Christian. We're all of one. And I introduced Jesus there because he's in that passage, by the way. Paul says, you're not of Jesus. You're not supposed to have a little Jesus sect over here. Of course, we're all here because of Jesus. But you're not supposed to say, well, I listen to Jesus' teaching. Well, I listen to Paul's teaching. Well, I listen to Cephas' teaching, or Peter. He uses the word Cephas in that passage. No, we're all supposed to be one in the body of Christ. And we need to be more unified than we are. But he says, who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him? And he tells him, you have both seen him. It is he who is talking with you. And we must also make every effort to reveal Jesus as plainly to someone as we can. Be very clear who the Savior is. Don't, when you are sharing the gospel, be very careful not to say, just trust God. I know that for many of us, that's synonymous, right, with Jesus, with the God of the Bible, with the truth. I get that. But you need to be very clear who the Savior is, and there is only one name under heaven, given among men, whereby we must be saved. There's only one. That's the name of Jesus. Don't muddy the waters with people, because honestly, people, they get confused. When you say God, which God do you mean? That's the way an unbelieving person looks at it. Do you mean Buddha? Do you mean Muhammad? Well, Muhammad's just a prophet. But do you mean Allah? Do you mean, you know, the God of the Jehovah's Witnesses? Do you mean the God of the Mormons back here behind us? You need to know these gods are not the same. They claim to be preaching Jesus, a very different Jesus in those two cults back here. Jesus to Islam is just a prophet. He can't be, and he is not, the Son of God to them. The Hadith says very clearly, God has no son. No Islamic person is ever going to say Jesus is the Son of God. That doesn't exist in Islam. This is important stuff. But Lord, I believe, and notice the result of his belief. Look at verse 38. Then he said, Lord, I believe. I have faith, Lord. And then what? And he worshiped him. What should happen when a person converts to Christ genuinely? Worship. A person will become humble before Almighty God, realizing he is God and we are not. This is why repentance is so tightly coupled in every case with conversion, because God is going to lead a person away from their sin. He's going to forgive their sin. And Jesus' words are always to people when he's preaching to them. Do you remember? Go and sin no more. You've been forgiven, but go and sin no more. Repentance is always tied in here. And notice, it's going to drive somebody to fall on their face in worship before Almighty God, realizing what's happened. Do you notice? It's not all said here, but Jesus is going to clarify in just a second. It's not all said here, but this man immediately believes and falls on his face in worship before God. That's what's happening. Worship means to prostrate oneself. He is falling down before Jesus, worshiping him. Jesus is accepting this worship. Why? Because he's God. He's the Son of God. He's Savior. But this is what's happening. This will always happen with a true heart of conversion. If you find a person who says, I've believed in Jesus, and they start to live their life like they used to, they're not humbling themselves before God. They aren't falling down in worship. There's no sense or identity that they're keeping the commandments, that the Word of God, that God himself have been elevated in their lives. You need to know they're probably not genuinely saved. They've been convinced that praying a prayer was the thing that led them to faith. It can't happen that way. God has to change a heart before somebody can believe. And that's what's been happening here in this passage. God has converted this man's heart. When Jesus said, do you believe in the Son of Man? The guy said, who is he? Show me, tell me. I want to worship him. I want to bow down. And that's exactly what he did when he found out who he was. This is critical. the marks of true belief. Confession from the mouth, I believe, and then worship. He's saying to him, you know, you're Lord. I believe you're my God and Savior. And certainly over time, you know, in all of our lives, I hope, we start to question any Christian, so-called Christian, who claims to be following Christ but doesn't live for Christ the way Christ said to live. If you're not, why? Why are you leaving them in a state of limbo that could be leading to them going to hell if they stay there? This is huge. Look at what Jesus says next. For judgment I have come into this world, that those who do not see may see, and that those who see may be made blind. Jesus starts to go away from physical blindness now, and he converts this into a spiritual matter. Now, he's already dealt with the salvation of this one man, but there are other people standing around listening to them. You need to understand, and you're going to see it right here. They start to ask a question in a moment. There are other people watching him convert this man or this man come to faith right in front of him. His next words are, I've come into this world for judgment. Now, what does he mean by that? I've come here to send you all to hell right now? No, that's not what he means. What is he saying? Well, something more like this. Let me read this to you from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 17 and 18, and maybe it'll make it more clear. For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? Now, if the righteous one is scarcely saved, where will the ungodly and the sinner appear? See, Jesus came into the world, and people are going to have to be on one side or the other. Ultimately, the judgment is going to fall on everybody. Either you are Christ's and saved by his blood and redeemed by him, or you are not. There are no two sides. There are blind people, in a spiritual sense, right, who reject God entirely and they remain blind forever. There are sighted people who are changed and transformed by God. They get their spiritual sight and they keep that forever. Do you see the two sides? And this passage unfolds and unwinds this for us clearly. Look what else is said here. Then some of the Pharisees, verse 40, who were with him, heard these words and said to him, are we blind also? Notice there's other people standing here. This isn't a one-on-one gospel presentation. It's a one-on-one in the sense he's saving this one man, but there are other people still standing here, including some of these Pharisees. And they say, Lord, they don't call him Lord, of course. They say to him, are we blind also? They don't believe they're blind, people. Beloved, you need to know they do not believe they're blind. They think they see. They think God is just fine with how they live. They believe they're keeping the law of God, the law of Moses, and that's what God required, and so they believe they're okay. They're God's chosen people. They keep the law, so they're good. That's not true, is it? Salvation is not of works, ever. It wasn't for them, and it isn't for us today. The first demand, and you'll notice this back to Abraham if you want to go all the way back starting in Genesis 12, the first idea of coming to God is in faith. Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Yes, he got up and did what God said, but that isn't what God gained him righteousness. Righteousness was the fact that when God said something, he believed it. And that's what the Jews should have been doing, but they weren't. They had become hypocrites, false teachers, false understanding. But notice, are we blind also? And here's Jesus' answer. Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no sin. But now you say, we see, therefore your sin remains. Now notice what he's saying. Because again, he's used blindness in the opposite sense this whole time, right? Even in the spiritual sense, he's saying, look, I'm coming to blind those who say they see. And I'm coming to give sight to those who are actually blind. Those who are in spiritual darkness and lostness, and they know they're lost. What Jesus said this in a different way. Do you remember? Those who are well have no need of a physician. See, the only people that are going to accept the salvation and the medication from the great physician are going to be those who know they're sick. They have a problem. They aren't with God, and God isn't with them. They can be saved. A person who says, I see, and I'm okay, God likes me and knows me just how I am, that's absolutely false. And that's what Jesus is saying. A person like that, like these Pharisees, they are completely blind because they say, we see. They say we're okay. We're all right. God's going to save us. We're His chosen people. We keep the law of God. We're good. How many Christians are doing this today? How many Christians think that God has the big scoreboard in heaven and they think, hey, if I just do enough good stuff, it'll outweigh the bad I did and God is going to let me into heaven? That is false. There isn't one word in the New Testament or, frankly, in the Bible at all that would give you that indication. The only way to be saved is through faith in Christ. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we, those who have placed faith, right? For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God before ordained that we should walk in them. The good works come as a result of faith. Faith is the only way to be reconciled with God. And it is only faith in Christ and the work He did as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. That is the only way to be saved. They will not yield to the Messiah, to God, and ultimately to the Savior who goes to a cross, who these very same people are going to be people who hang Jesus on a cross, claiming He's a blasphemer, claiming that He makes Himself out to be God when He's just a man, and He will go to a cross. We're thankful He went to the cross, but from them it's evil, but from God it was for good. This is huge. Listen to this. I'm going to leave you with this and then conclude the sermon. Proverbs 26:12. Do you see a man wise in his own eyes? There is more hope for a fool than for him. That's from the Proverbs. If you think you are wise and you got it all figured out and you know better than everybody else, there's more hope for fools. Fools reject God outright. There's more hope for them than there is for someone who thinks he's got it all worked out and that you know everything and that you're at the pinnacle of knowledge and understanding. We're not. None of us are, folks. Humble ourselves before the mighty hand of God, and He will lift us up. Can you see how Jesus has just laid out a perfect yet simple gospel presentation? There's no fluff in there. There's just the stuff that's required. Who is God? Who is the Savior? What's the condition of man? He's a sinner. He's rebelled against God, and he needs to be saved. He has a sickness or a problem, a separation from God. He needs Jesus to save him. And that's what happens here. This man believes, but many don't. And many don't even recognize their own blindness in face of who the Savior is, believing themselves to be wise. And the only question left is the question that is already on that board and it's been there all morning. Do you believe in the Son of God? And I'm going to leave that question with you. You need to trust Jesus. If you haven't trusted Him, bow yourself and humble yourself and trust. Otherwise, you are going to be blinded forever, and there's nothing I can do about that. That's an act and a work of God to bring about permanent spiritual blindness. That's an act of God, just like it is to bring about spiritual faith and spiritual sight. Let's pray together. I hope you'll heed those words. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for who you are, again, knowing that you are the great God of heaven, the Almighty God. You are our Father for those of us who have trusted you. Even those of us who are Gentiles, you have grafted into the olive tree of faith. And Father, you have brought us in with the Jews, and in the body of Christ, there's no Jew, there's no Gentile. It's all just one household of faith. And Father, we love you and praise you for this. It is a work that only you could have done, and you are still doing even to this day. And so, Father, we pray that each person here or each person who will hear will yield to you and yield to the gospel. Father, we pray that you'll save many and that you'll do this mighty work in our people, in our community, in our households, in our friends and neighbors' households. And Father, that you would be glorified in it all. We love you and praise you. We pray that you'll bless us as we work for the rest of the week for your glory. In Jesus' holy name, amen.